Thank you, Amir, and thanks for inviting me to give this talk. The title is Learning Fast Requires a Good Memory, Time-Space Trade-off Lower Bounds for Learning. I will talk about a recent line of work that studies time-space or memory samples, lower bounds for learning. The main message of many of these works is that for some learning problems, access to a relatively large memory is crucial, or in other words, in some cases, learning is infeasible because of memory constraints. And these are some of the works that we have seen in the last 5 years or so about this topic. So the original motivation for this line of works came from online learning theory. The study was initiated by two papers, one by Oad Shamir in 2014, and the other by Steinhardt, Gregory Valiant, and Wager in 2015. These two papers asked the question, can one prove unconditional lower bounds for the number of samples needed for learning under memory constraints? And you will see some examples. This was asked in the model of online learning, where the samples are viewed by the learner one by one. So let me give you the first example, and the first example is parity learning. In the problem of parity learning, there are n unknown bits, x1 to xn. They are all unknown and were chosen at random by the uniform distribution. And a learner tries to figure out, to learn x1 to xn. And the learner tries to do that from a stream of random linear equations over GF2, modulo 2. So the learner gets a stream of random linear equations in the unknowns, in the variables x1 to xn. The equations arrive one by one, and in the end, the learner has to know, with some probability, to guess x1 to xn. So, more formally, the learner gets a stream of samples, A1, B1, A2, B2, and so on, where in each time t, for each time t, AT is just a random vector in 0, 1 to the n, and BT, the free bit, is the inner product, modulo 2, of AT and X. The learner needs to solve the linear equations and figure out X1 to Xn. But again, the equations arrive one by one. And after you see an equation, it disappears and you cannot access the same equation anymore. There is no noise in this model, so it's all relatively simple. So this is the problem of parity learning. So the rules of the game are clear? Yes. So you are all ready to play? This is a demonstration that I gave already several times. You have to figure out x1 to x5 from a stream of linear equations, modulo 2. So I'm going to give you the stream, and in that you have to tell me what are x1 to x5. So the first equation is x1 plus x2 plus x3, x4 plus x5 equals 0. Then x2 plus x3 equals 0. x3 plus x4 plus x5 equals 0. x2 plus x3 plus x4 equals 0. x1 plus x2 plus x5 equals 0. That's your guess. x3 plus x4 equals 1. x2 plus x4 plus x5 equals 0. x1 plus x5 equals 1. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 equals 0. And x2 plus x3 plus x4 plus x5 equals 1. What?
That says x3 equals 1, and all the rest is 0.
Sorry?
That says x3 is equal to 1, and all the rest is 0.
No, x5. 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 X5
So all the guesses are good guesses because you have a probability of 1 over 31 except for 1 over 31 except for your guess 0 to be correct. I gave this demonstration already not 31 times but maybe 10 times and no one was ever able to solve it. So you could have just try one solution, each of you, and one of you at random would have solved it and, you know, get the credit of a genius forever.
Why don't you run it again?
You want to? I think we will better proceed. So, again, the learner gets a stream of linear equations over the variables x1 to xn and needs to solve these linear equations modulo 2 and to find the x1 to xn. In my example, yes, there is only one solution. In this problem, you are not guaranteed, but you get lots of samples, so after a little bit more than n samples, you are essentially guaranteed with very high probability that it's going to be unique. Because the equations are random, and also the solution was chosen randomly. So essentially, there are two ways to solve this problem, and the first is by solving linear equations. So in order to solve linear equations, you have to store in your memory of n samples a little bit more than n equations and then solve them. And the problem is that the memory size that is needed for that is quadratic. So n equations and each equation is n coefficients, so you need a quadratic memory size. And then the question is if there is a better way to do that. And for example, what if your memory is smaller than n squared? Maybe your memory is linear, or maybe even n squared over some constant, say over 10. Can you still solve the problem? And the answer is obviously that you can solve it even with linear memory if you allow exponential time or exponential number of equations. And this is, for example, by trying all the possibilities. You just try each possibility one by one. Each one of them, you try the next 2n equations. And if it satisfies all the next 2n equations, since they are random, you know that with high probability, this is the right solution. So that's the other way to solve it. But then the question is if there is a better way to do that. Maybe you can do that with less than exponential number of samples and less than n square memory. And the answer is that this is impossible. The theorem, this was first conjectured in the paper of Steinhardt, Valiant, and the Wager in 2015. And this was proved, I proved it in 2016. So this is a theorem that any algorithm for parity learning requires either a memory of size n squared over 10, or n squared over some constant, 10, or an exponential number of samples. This is exactly as they conjectured up to the constant. So previously to this result, there was no lower bound on the memory that is needed to solve it efficiently, no lower bound better than n. So, and for any learning problem. So if the size of the memory is smaller than n, then it's relatively easy to prove a lower bound. And this was known also in the context of a bounded storage cryptography. But for memory size larger than n, there was no previous lower bound. I will focus in this talk on such time space or memory samples lower bounds, trade-off lower bounds, where the lower bound on the memory is super linear. This will be the main focus of the talk. And I wanted to mention that the best upper bound is n squared over 4, roughly. And this is by just doing the Gaussian elimination correctly with trying to save memory. You can show that you can do that with memory of size n squared over 4. We still have a gap between the upper bound and the lower bound, but it's not such a large gap. On the what?
Trade-off
between the number of and
memory.
If I get a lower bound,
so
I
if you have a
trade-off. So essentially I get the best in both, right? I get that either you need n squared over 10 memory size or exponential number of samples. So essentially you get the lower bound is tight in both directions. With exponential number of samples, you can just go over all the possibilities, try all of them, and then with memory of size of n, you can output the correct answer with very high probability. Yes. I think that's what you all tried to do when I did the example, but you are right. Because the equations are random, you can just wait for the signal. Okay, let me tell you about some of the motivations for studying this problem. As I already mentioned, the first motivation for studying these problems came from machine learning theory, from online learning, and in the context of machine learning, these results show that for some online problems, access to relatively large memory is crucial, or if you want, in some cases, in other words, in some cases, learning is infeasible because of memory constraints if each sample is viewed only once. More generally, it's very interesting to study how much memory is needed for learning for learning of certain problems. And already the result that I gave, the parity result, already gives a concept class that can be efficiently learned if you have a memory of quadratic size, but for smaller than quadratic size, you cannot learn it efficiently. And if you want, good memory might be crucial in learning processes. So this is one motivation. And as an example, you can try to take a learning algorithm that tries to model a problem by a neural network. And today, many learning algorithms try to model a concept by a neural network. And many times, what these algorithms do, they store in the memory a neural network. And then when new samples arrive, the algorithms update the weights of the neural networks, the weights of the neural network, and then the hope is that finally the neural network will give the concept that you need to study. Okay, so you just represent the real numbers by finite precision, yes. And the important thing to notice here that the memory used by the algorithm is the size of the neural network. And when I say here the size of the neural network, I mean the number of bits needed to represent the neural network to some precision. Yeah, you always work with some precision. The memory of the algorithm is bounded by something that, by the size of the neural network. And the conclusion is that such algorithms cannot learn certain concept classes if each sample is viewed only once and if the size of the neural network is not sufficiently large. And for example, for learning parities, you need a neural network that can be described by quadratic number of bits. So this is an example. Yes. No, I cannot. So this result is only for one pass over all the samples. We also have a very recent result that I will mention later on. for two passes over the samples with the exact same order. But that's only the only thing that we know. Even three passes is still open. But this result that I just talked about is for one pass over the inputs. No, not for parity. And well, I'm sure that you can't find an example for a learning problem where it gives you an advantage. But for parity, I don't know any algorithm that takes advantage of like a small number of passes. But if you allow any number of passes that you want, then you can do that by Valiant's result for you can take any arithmetic circuit and you can do that in parallel with small d. So if you allow like poly n number of passes, then you can do that maybe in quasi polynomial time or something like that. Another set of applications of these results is for bounded storage cryptography. In bounded storage cryptography, Ellis and Bob, two parties, try to communicate securely or perform some other cryptographical task in the presence of an adversary with bounded memory size. So I'm not really going to talk about these applications. I'm just going to say that there are applications to bounded storage cryptography. In my paper, I gave an application as a secret key encryption and decryption protocol in bounded storage cryptography. And there is a very recent paper by Guan and Zandri, beautiful paper, that shows protocols for key agreement, bit commitment, and oblivious transfer using the parity result that I described before. And all these protocols have some advantages over what was previously known in the model of bounded storage cryptography. Another motivation comes from complexity theory, and I'm also not really going too much into that. I'm not going to go too much into that, but in complexity theory, time-space lower bounds were studied in many different settings and many different models. So also from the point of view of complexity theory, we might be interested in studying time-space trade-offs for learning. I'm going to skip this slide. Another possible motivation is for pseudo-random generators. For example, for pseudo-random generators for log space. So using these results, we can construct pseudo-random generators for log space with seed of size polylog n, but we don't know how to match, not match and not pass the best pseudo-random generators, the best seed length for pseudo-random generators for log space by Noam Nissan and several other works. And also the techniques are not too much different, except, I mean, the proofs are different, but the generator that you get is not that much different. So at this point, it's just a motivation for a future work. So these are the motivations that we have to study these problems. And what I want to do now is to tell you about some more results that we have of this type, of time-space trade-off lower bounds for learning. And the first result, the next result that I'm going to mention is a result in a paper with Gilad Kohl and Avishai Tal. And in this paper, we studied time-space trade-offs, memory samples, lower bounds, for sparse parities. So what is sparse parities learning? It's exactly like parity learning, but you know in addition that x1 to xn, that x1 to xn is a sparse vector. So in x1 to xn, there are only k ones and the rest are zero. And it was chosen randomly, and uniformly among all these vectors. So this is sparsity K parity learning, and what we prove more or less is that for sparse parity learning, when the sparsity is log n or even a little bit smaller, larger than log n or even a little bit smaller, you need either superlinear memory size or super polynomial number of samples. And what we have here is two results. For any sparsity case, let's say smaller than n to the 0.99, but even this is not really needed, this restriction, we have two results. The first result says that you need either omega of n times k memory bits or 2 to the omega of k samples. This is the first result. And the second result is a little bit different. It says that you need either omega of n times k to the 1 minus epsilon memory bits or k to the omega k samples. The second result for me is more interesting for the following reason. In the second result, if k is logarithmic, is k is log n or even a little bit smaller than log n, for example, epsilon times log n, then the memory that the bound on the memory is superlinear, and the bound on the number of samples is super polynomial. So if k is like epsilon log n, you get that you need either superlinear memory size or a super polynomial number of samples. And this is for k epsilon log n or larger.
That's
what? Yes. So this is not really a trade-off, but for you can view the two results as trade-off, and you can get yes. We know how to prove that too. Not in this, the same result. Not in this paper, but in follow-up papers that I will still mention. Yes, it applies when the. So the question was when the equations are sparse and x1 to xn is just random, yes, we know how to prove exactly the same results. Yes. So this is an interesting question. These results, what? If we have an algorithm for this running time, so there are non-trivial upper bounds for this problem. And this lower bound is not exactly tight, but close to be tight. So we get an, if the number of samples is k plus log n to the k, we can get to sublinear memory. There is an upper bound, such an upper bound. We have it in the paper. So this result is close to be tight. So you can always consider exponential number of samples, like when you can wait for singletons and then you don't need memory at all, but except for such trivial algorithms. Okay, so why I'm interested so much in sparsity of about log n, of about epsilon log n? The reason is that many other learning problems that were considered can be we can get now results for them by a reduction. So the problem of learning sparse parity, where the sparsity is epsilon log n, can be reduced to many other learning problems. For example, learning a linear size CNF or linear size DNF or linear size decision tree or log n size juntas. So all these learning problems, for all these learning problems, now by a reduction, we get time-space lower bounds. We get memory samples trade-offs exactly as here. So exactly as here. We get that you need, for all these learning problems, either a superlinear memory or a super polynomial number of samples. And for these learning problems, these are not known to be tight results. So we don't, it's still open to get tight results. This is also a very good question. Quadratic is tight in the information theoretical model. So if you don't take complexity into account, the complexity of the learner, but just we will see when we see what is the model of the learner. We model it as a branching program, which means that we only take into account the memory needed by the learner, and we allow the learner infinite computational complexity. So if you don't take this into account, if you don't want to prove lower bounds for computational complexity classes, then on n squared is optimal. For all problems. You cannot get any better lower bound without hitting complexity barriers. If you only work in the problem of in the model of branching program, this is the best that you can do. Yes, yes. You just remember n samples, and from them information theoretically you can figure out what was x1 to xn. If you allow for sparse parities, I'm not sure what is the answer. We don't. We do have a lower bound for two passes, but not for more than that. For sparse, also for sparse. Almost all the lower bounds that we have for one time pass, we also have for two time pass, but not the same lower bound. They are worse lower bounds, but we can we can get some lower bounds. Okay, so after that there was a sequence of works that study memory samples lower bounds for larger classes of learning problems. So far we only discussed parity and sparse parities and problems that can be reduced to the problems that sparse parity can reduce to them. But then we started to study memory samples lower bounds for large classes of learning problems. There was a sequence of results. So I had a result in 2017. About it, it proves that for a large class of learning problems, any learning algorithm requires either a quadratic memory size or exponential number of samples. In particular, it gave another proof for the parity learning problem. There was later on, a few months after, a paper by Dana Moshkovitz and Michal Moshkovitz, and they gave essentially the same result. Later on, there were two papers, one by Beam, Oves, Garan, and Young, and the other by myself with Sumega Garg and Avishai Tal, in which we gave lower bounds for even larger classes of learning problems. I will tell about these results. These two papers are very similar and were independently at the same time. Both of these papers, so I will focus in the rest of the talk on R17 and the GRT18. Both of these papers build on the techniques from R17. So both of these papers build on R17. The paper by Moshkovitz and Moshkovitz build on an earlier paper that they had in 2017 that was independent of R17, and they gave essentially the same thing but with linear lower bound of 1.25n on the memory size. So it's only a linear lower bound but larger than n. So that was the point. So I will focus on R17 and GRT18 in the rest of the talk. And I wanted to mention that there are additional follow-up works that build on the techniques that, as time allows, and well, I won't have too much time to show you, that build on the techniques of R17. And there are, in particular, these two papers. One of them is by Sharan, Sidford, and Valiant from last store, and this they give memory samples lower bounds. They build on the on these techniques to build to give memory samples lower bounds for linear regression with small error. And this is very interesting, might be a turning point in this line of work, because this is kind of the first time that we get some results for problems that are interesting in practice. So this is a problem that is applied in practice many times, linear regression. And this is the paper that I already talked about before for two-pass learning. Together with Sumega Garg and Avishai Tal, also from this year, we get some results for two-pass learning, learning when you read twice the samples in the exact same order, but the results are not as strong as what we currently have for one-pass learning. So they are somewhat weaker. Sorry? I don't know of any such lower bound. I tried to think a little bit in this direction, but I don't know of any significant result that you're looking for. It's a good idea to try. Okay, so I'm going to focus now on R17 and GRT18, and in particular I want to present a result from GRT18, and in order to do that, I want to show you how to describe a learning problem by a matrix. So for any learning problem of the type that we study here, we have a matrix that describes the problem, that corresponds to the problem. And the matrix is as follows. So we think of it as we have two finite sets, A and X. So X is the concept class that we are trying to learn. In the parity learning example, it's 0, 1 to the n. A is the set of all possible samples. In the set of parity in the case of parity learning, it's also 0, 1 to the n. Now suppose that we have a matrix M from A times X to minus 1, 1. Let's say minus 1, 1 rather than 0, 1. So for every such matrix M, we have a corresponding learning problem. And what is the corresponding learning problem for such a matrix M? So the learning problem is as follows. We take X to be an unknown column that was chosen randomly. X is what we have to learn. We have to learn which column was chosen. A learner tries to learn X from a stream of samples, A1, B1, A2, B2, and so on as before, where for each time t, at is just a random row of the matrix, and bt is the entry m of at and x, is the entry of this row. So a random column was chosen, and then you get random coordinates in that column, and from that you have to tell what was the column. So this is like a general way to describe learning problems of the type that we want to study. And for each learning problem, there is a corresponding matrix and vice versa. So now the theorem that we had in the paper with Sumega Garg and Avishai Tal is the following theorem. So more or less the theorem says that if the matrix M is a matrix of a two-source extractor, you can get lower bounds. You can get memory samples, trade-off lower bounds. And I will show exactly what I mean. You don't have to know the notion of a two-source extractor. So the theorem is as follows. The assumption is that in the matrix M, any submatrix of fraction 2 to the minus k times 2 to the minus l has bias of at most 2 to the minus r. So if you count the number of 1s and the number of minus 1, the probability for 1 would be between half plus 2 to the minus r and half minus 2 to the minus r. So in that case, the corresponding learning problem we have a memory sample's lower bounds, and the memory sample's lower bounds is the following. You need either a memory of size omega of k times L, or 2 to the omega of r samples, one of them. So either this number of samples or memory size. And in particular, for a large class of problems, k is about log a, and L is about log x, and r is... and 2 to the r is exponential, so you get that for a large class of learning problems, you need either a memory of size omega of log a log x or an exponential number of samples. So this is the main result that we have. It implies all previous results. It doesn't imply the two other results that I described of Charan, Seedford, and Valiant, and the two-pass learning result, but it implies all previous results in this line of works that prove lower bounds of larger than linear memory size. The proof technique is new. So this paper builds on this paper. So the proof technique, in particular, we get a new proof for the parity learning result. And I have to mention, I already mentioned that there was a related work by Beam, Oves, Garand, and Young, also building on R17, that gives, they don't have exactly this theorem, but they do similar things. So these two papers were independent and do more or less the same thing.
Maybe a section that all sub-matrices will have
No.
Bias,
no. You're right. Yes. You're right. Yeah, we could state it in different ways. Yes. I'm surprised. Yes, the answer is yes. I'm surprised. I don't see any reason for that. It comes in the proof, but we don't really know why. But again, it's just a lower. So the question was about the symmetry here. Are we surprised that it's symmetric? The role of A and X is the same in this theorem. And yes, it's surprising. But the point is that this is only a lower bound. So it's not an upper bound. So, you know, that's why it's surprising, but maybe something else could be proved. I don't see why it should be symmetric, and I don't think that in general it should be. So the answer is yes, we should be surprised. I'm surprised. Okay, so let me tell you about some applications of this result. One application is what Adi asked before. It's not on my slides, but this is one application in our paper. The two applications that I wanted to tell about is first learning from low degree equations. So you have, again, x1 to xn, which was chosen randomly in 0, 1 to the n. And now you get, instead of linear equations in x1 to xn, you get low degree equations. You get polynomial equations of degree d. So each sample now is of size n to the d in general. And now the theorem says that you need either a memory of omega of n to the d plus 1 or an exponential number of samples. So this is one application. The other application that I'm going to mention is the other way around. The learner tries to learn an n-variable multilinear polynomial of degree d. So it's n to the d, about n to the d bits over GF2. And you want to learn that from random evaluations of that polynomials over 0, 1 to the n, over GF2 to the n. And again, it requires either a memory of size omega of n to the d plus 1 or an exponential number of samples. And you can talk about error-correcting codes or random matrices. There are also other applications. On what? So it's multilinear. Let's talk about multilinear polynomials. So yes. Also for linear D. Yes. So I think it's more interesting in the case that the samples are large, and so you get like very large samples, and you like the first result that you want to learn x1 to xn from low degree polynomials when these large, it might be very interesting. Yes. But it's not, it's even for linear D. Okay, so you are, so possibly, so we know some results about errors, but I'm not going to talk about them in this talk. So
you give answers with a certain probability of error.
No, but the model was. As I defined it, it doesn't include errors, but we can also study this case, and we have results for the case of errors. Like, that are better than what you have without errors. Okay, so now maybe it's the time to tell you what is the model that we are considering, the computational model. And this is the model of a branching program. So what is a branching program of length M and width D? And let's say that we only talk about parity learning just because it would be more convenient. It's not, we don't, the model is general. So what is a branching program of length M and width D? It's a layered graph that has M layers, actually M plus one layers. This is the first layer, and this is layer zero, and then M layers, where each layer has D vertices. And the way we think about it is that each layer represents a time step, and each vertex in a layer represents a memory state of the learner in that time step. Each non-leaf vertex here is labeled by each non-leaf vertex here has 2^n+1 edges outgoing from it, and they are all labeled by all possible equations. And they go to the from this layer to the next layer, and so on. This is a branching program. Let's think of it as a branching program for parity learning. And now when you get samples, A1, B1, A2, B2, and so on, AM, BM, these samples define a computation path in the branching program. You start from this vertex, the first vertex that is the start vertex, and you follow the samples that you get, and finally you get to the last layer, and then each vertex V in the last layer is labeled by some string in 0, 1 to the end, which is supposed to be the answer that is given by the branching program for that vertex. So this is the way a branching program works. You start from the start vertex, you follow the computation path, and you output that vertex, that string, the string that labels the final vertex that you reach to. So this is the computational model that we consider, and this is the most general and strongest computational model that can be considered for this kind of problems. It's a non-uniform model, and for example, now we can state the result for the parity learning formally. The result is that any branching program for parity learning, if the width of the branching program is less than 2^n² over, let's say, 20. So the memory is the log of the width, the log of the number of vertices in each layer. So if the width is smaller than 2^n² over 20, and the length is smaller than 2^n over 100, then the output is correct with exponentially small probability. This is something that I still didn't say, but it's true that all the results work even for a learner that guesses the right value with exponentially small probability. So this is the result for parity learning in the language of branching programming. Okay, so I was hoping to have more time for the proof outline, but I don't. But I will start and give you some, at least one, two ideas from the proof. And so I will talk about the proof technique for only for parity learning and the proof technique from this paper. And again, there are several papers already that build on these proof techniques. Let's assume that we have a branching program. Assume for a contradiction. Assume that we have a branching, or not for a contradiction. Assume that we have a branching program that is supposed to learn parity. And the length of the program is smaller than 2 to the n over some large constant. It's less than exponential, 2 to the n over some constant. And assume that it solves the problem with some constant probability. What we want to prove, so yeah, it is a subject for a contradiction. We want to prove that the width of the program is large. So let me tell you one interesting idea in the proof, and then, I won't have too much time, but I will say something more about it. What we do is the following. We take the branching program, and we mark the significant vertices in the program. So what is a significant vertex? A significant vertex informally is a vertex V such that conditioned on the event that the program, that the computation path reached that vertex, the correct X can be guessed with non-negligible probability. I'm not saying what's exactly non-negligible probability, but it does it. For this slide, it's not so important. Sorry? The probabilities over x1 to xn and all the samples, over the solution and the sample. Yeah. So again, a significant vertex is a vertex V such that if we reach that vertex, we can guess correctly or not correctly with non-negligible probability the right answer. The goal of the branch... Without the future, yes. Already in that vertex, we have enough information to guess x1 to xn with non-negligible probability. At the vertex V itself, yes. Yeah, the vertex V can be also in the last layer, but it could be an intermediate vertex in some of the layers. The goal of the branching program is to reach such a vertex, a significant vertex. And for us, as we want to show that it cannot reach a significant vertex except with very small probability, except with negligible probability. So we define the probability of V as the probability that the computation path reaches the vertex V, and we want to show that this probability is small. So actually what we would have wanted to show, that this probability is smaller than 2 to the minus omega of n squared, and then we would have been done by the union bound. There must be at least 2 to the omega n squared significant vertices, and therefore the width must be at least 2 to the omega n squared, and that's it. But unfortunately, this is not true. There are significant vertices that we reach with probability much larger than 2 to the minus omega n squared, like 2 to the minus n or something like that. It's still very small, but only exponentially small. And we need lower bound that would be quadratic of the memory size. So what we do in like a high level view, we define a global event B, and this event B is the event that some atypical things happen. Some atypical things happen in the system, and the probability for this event would be exponentially small, like 2 to the minus n, something like that. So this event is negligible, but it's a global event that some atypical things happen. And now what we do, we prove that the probability is exponentially small, and for each significant vertex V, we prove that the probability to get to V conditioned on the complement of B is to the minus omega of n square, and we can still apply the union bound and get to the omega of n square lower bound for the memory size. So I think it's an interesting thing that there is like a global event B that if you take away that global event, then you can apply the union bound as we wanted originally. Yes. It's more complicated. The event itself is more complicated. It depends on the branching program. Yes, it depends on the branching program. I still have time, so let me tell a little bit more about that. So what we do in the proof, we define a path T over the branching program. And what is this path T? It would be very similar to the computation path. Very similar, except that sometimes it will stop. When bad things happen, atypical things happen, the path will stop. But otherwise, it will follow the computation path. And the probability that it stops would be exponentially small. We can prove that. So the event from the last slide, the event B, would be the event that T stops. If T stops with very small probability, but if it doesn't stop, it follows the computation path. And this is an interesting point. It doesn't depend only on the vertex. It depends also it depends on other things except the vertex. But it depends on your probability space, yes. It's a lower bound. It's a proof. The event B cheats in many ways. It's it has large memory and it looks, it knows the exact x1 to xn, it cheats. But anyway, the structure of the proof is that we define a path T that sometimes stops. There are specific stopping rules that tell you when T stops, when atypical things happen. The probability that T stops is exponentially small. But now, if T doesn't stop, then we can prove that the probability to get to a for every significant vertex V, the probability to get to that significant vertex is of the order of 2 to the minus omega of n square, and therefore there must be 2 to the omega of n square significant vertices. So this is more or less what we do. I want to say a little bit more about that. So first, a proof outline of how we prove, so this is the hard part of how to prove that we get to a significant vertex. Now I change it to S. The probability to get to a significant vertex S is exponentially small, is actually less than exponentially small, is 2 to the minus omega of n squared. In order to do that, we define a progress function of how much progress the program did to reach a distribution close to the probability of X conditioned on S. And this is the progress function we define for every layer of the program Zi to be the sum over all the vertices in that layer of the probability to get to that vertex. And now we take the conditional distribution of X conditioned on V, inner product with the distribution of X conditioned on S to the power of delta N, where delta is a small constant. This is the progress function. What we can do, we can compute exactly the progress function at the beginning, because then this is the uniform distribution. We show that this is very slowly growing. So the final progress of the program would still be small. And then, because S is a part of, let's say, the last layer, in the end, the program must have done progress, and this is the contradiction.
Assuming here that nothing did go at right,
yes.
So
yes. Yes, yes, yes. And you are right, the other steps are easy. Step two is where all the work is done. I don't know how you figured it out already, but yes, the first, the second step, what? Okay, so I don't know how you read all the slide already. okay, I'm not, delta is a constant, a small constant. Yes, yes, for parity learning it's not really important, it's just a small constant, and for other problems, this can change delta n, and the definition of significant vertex can change. There is like, they are all parameters. So, yeah, so since I have only 3 minutes, I won't go into this proof at all, although this was also very sketchy, but I will just end up telling you what are the stopping rules of the path T. So the stopping rules, you stop on a vertex V if one of the followings occur. The first one is that if you look on the distribution of X conditioned on reaching that vertex V by the path T is large, then you stop. This means that V is significant. If you hit a significant vertex, you stop. The second is that the probability of X conditioned of V of the correct X is large. So this is where we cheat. We define the stopping rule knowing the correct X. So this is a second stopping rule. And the third rule is that the next edge corresponds to a large Fourier coefficient of the X condition on V. So these are the rules. What is interesting here is, okay, so first they do not depend on V. It should be V here. They do not depend on the vertex V. This we must have because we want it to be a global event that doesn't depend on just one event. That doesn't depend, not a different, oh, sorry. This is not a mistake. They do not depend on S, they do depend on V. They do not depend on S. So this is because we want it to be a global event that doesn't depend on the target significant vertex for which we want to prove. So this is necessary for this proof technique. And the second is that they do depend on X. So they are cheating in many ways, but nevertheless, this is an event that you can consider and do everything conditioned on the complement of that event. And I will stop here. This is a summary of the main result, the main message for a large class of learning problems. And any learning algorithm requires either superlinear memory size or super polynomial number of samples. For some learning problems, access to a relatively large memory is crucial. Thank you. Yes. So you want a model that goes randomly wander around. We don't have any result for that. That would be very interesting, yeah, but we don't have any result for that at this point. Even the result for two passes is just one after the other in the exact same model. Yes. And again, if you don't even limit the number of passes, then you hit complexity theory lower bounds. Then you prove lower bounds for computations, and so for memory size of computation.
So are there algorithms, if you have a random excess, like unlimited number of passes, that are better than...
Yes, and this is by arithmetic circuit complexity, by Valiant, and colleagues' results that you can if you can do many passes, it's just like computation. You can just it's as if you just stored the samples and you run some algorithm over it, and then if you want to prove lower bounds, you have to prove lower bounds for algorithms, and that we still don't know. So so you hit like barriers of complexity theory.
Thank you. Sorry, say again?
Does it result in anything about the Islamist program
for computation? It doesn't imply anything, and it's again a good direction to think about, and but I don't know that it implies anything for computation. But yeah, it's a very good direction.